business.
Okay?
Yep.
So, which is the panel members?
Hello, yeah. Hello.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the post-lunch session of the National Business Conclave on the theme Challenges in the Dynamic Business Environment. It gives us immense pleasure and honor that I, Shruti Atlakha,
and I, Sayed Zakir, to be the masters of the ceremony. We all are eagerly waiting for the much-awaited panel discussion on the topic Disruptive Leadership. We would like to welcome all our panel members with a huge round of applause.
Thanks.
The first panel member for the session would be Ms. Sharmila Amin, Managing Director, South Asia India, Bertling Logistic India Private Limited. May I now call upon Dr. Suresh Chandrapadi, Director IB, to welcome ma'am with a bouquet.
I call upon student manager Nidhi Singh to introduce our guest.
Very good afternoon to one and all. I feel honored to introduce amongst you all Ms. Sharmila Amin, Managing Director, Bertling Logistic of South Asia, India. Ma'am was the head of PAN projects in South Asia, India Panalpina Group. Ma'am holds a bachelor degree in commerce from the University of Mumbai as well as degree in shipping management from Indian Institute of Management in Ahmedabad. Ma'am is also a custom rule 9 license holder. Presently, ma'am is also an independent director with Hindustan Oil Exploration Corporation, listed corporation on stock exchange. Ma'am is a General Secretary for Vista India, Women International Shipping and Trading Association. With over 25 years of experience, ma'am has executed multiple projects in the power generation, petrochemical, fertilizer, automobile, oil and gas, and other core industry sectors. Ma'am is not only one of the most successful top executive business lady in the Indian logistic industry, but also the only woman in the project's logistic business. Ma'am, I welcome you for the panel discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
The next panel member for the session would be Mr. Chandan Chattaraj, President HR, Indian Global, Uflex Industries Limited. May I now call upon Brigadier M.L. Bumbani, Advisor, Sri Balaji Society, to welcome sir with a bouquet.
I call upon student manager Megha Barve to introduce our guest.
Good afternoon, one and all present here. I feel immense pleasure in introducing Mr. Chandan Chattaraj, President, Global Human Resources, Uflex Limited. Mr. Chandan, an alumnus of Xavier's Institute of Social Sciences, comes with an extensive experience in people development and change management from varied industry sectors. His stint prior to Uflex was with Aircel as Chief Human Resources Officer, where sir led the HR function. Sir has also worked with many renowned companies. Some of them are Oberoi Group, Xerox India, and Tata Steel. Sir has been conferred with many distinguished awards. Some of them are the Most Powerful HR Professionals of the India Award, HR Leadership Award, HR Professional of the Year Award, and many more. Under Sir's leadership, the UFlex HR team has won many accolades. Sir, I welcome you for the panel discussion. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Let me take the opportunity to introduce our guest of honor, Ms. Swapna Jaladi, Head HR India Magnitude Software.
May I call upon Student Manager Devang Rajgaur to introduce our guest.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It is a moment of honor for me to introduce Madam Swapna Jaladi, Head HR India Magnitude Software. Madam, I have over 17 years of core experience in all the facets of HR, that is business partner, HR process and policies, compensation rewards development, and employee relations. Madam has also have deep expertise in talent management, HR transition, and many more. Ma'am, I welcome you to this panel discussion, and I welcome you all for this panel discussion. Thank you.
The moderator for today's session would be Mr. Srikanth K., Managing Director, CSC India and Global Lead, Workforce Management.
I would like to call upon Dr. Suresh Chandrapadi, Director BIIB on the dais to elucidate the topic for today's panel discussion and start the event.
Okay, I think I have come here only to click photographs with all the guests, not to give any kind of panel discussion to illustrate. But at the same time, let me tell you, we have chosen a topic, disruptive leadership, which is highly essential in today's context. We have very eminent panel members. Four companies are there who are the decision maker. Day and night, they take this disruptive leadership. They face disruptive leadership. Somebody is taking this disruptive leadership as a challenge. Somebody take it as an opportunity. Somebody face it. Somebody denied it. But whether somebody want it or not, this is the reality of the world. So I'm very sure all the panel members will give their views on it, and I'm very sure the students will learn a lot from it. Once again, I welcome all the panel members to take this ahead, this panel, the topic of disruptive leadership, and give your views. Thank you very much once again coming to this.
Good stuff. Okay. My God. So starting with the disruption. So I don't want to, nice coach, I don't want to sit there and sleep.
So, good afternoon.
So Sharmila told me, look, afternoon session, after lunch, people already, long day, had many speakers coming and talking to you. I know how difficult to sit in one place. I can't sit in one place more than 1 hour. And it's very challenging. So I really appreciate you sitting tight and listening to many speakers. Afternoon sessions are very challenging. So Sharmila requested we need to do a small exercise to keep everybody awake. But I don't think they require exercise. We require exercise to keep us awake. Yeah. Today's format of the panel discussion, I will kick off with giving some perspective on disruption. Then my co-panel member, Chandan, will be talking his perspective. You have very diverse experience working in different firms which have gone through very difficult times and gone through huge transformation. So Chandan will share his perspective. Then both Chandan and myself will be triggering some thoughts from both Sharmila as well as Swapna, asking a few questions to them. What has been their journey and their experience in their career, or it can be in their personal life, and how they challenged and how they overcome these challenges from the disruption. Then we'll open up for you to ask questions to any of our panel members on your thoughts, your challenges, and also we'll welcome any of your disruption in your personal life or your students' life, or you may have some experience. Some of you come from corporate life, you may have faced some disruption in your company. You want to share your stories, your experience, you are welcome. So let it be a learning experience. So as you see in the screen, if you really Google the topic disruption, you'll find many, many interesting topics around the theme of disruption, disruptive leader, disruptive technology, disruptive business models. And the core message from all this article will be either you need to disrupt as a leader or you get disrupted by somebody else. These are the core themes you'll find in all these articles. Can you disrupt something, or are you ready to face the disruption created by something? I don't know what that something we'll discuss. It can be technology, it can be a fellow leader sitting next to you, or disruption from another vendor, or disruption by customer, or disruption by another geography, or whatever it may be. We have many case studies around where the disruption comes. So that's what I am going to share with you. Are you ready to do that? Are you ready as a leader to create disruption? Yes. So when disruption happening, like Suresh mentioned it, how are you going to face it? Are you going to deny it? Are you going to embrace it? Or are you going to ignore it? This is one of the challenges. So I have been looking at the competency models of many companies. So they put change management, ability to walk in ambiguous situation, ability to face disruption. I started seeing these kind of competencies in the leadership dictionary in the today's world. So what I would like to share with you in the next few minutes is what is disruption and what kind of disruptions organizations are facing. And I'll connect from my experiences, then I'll ask Chandan to share from his experience. The first one is, as you could see in the slide, when you see disruption, disruption brings a lot of noises, isn't it? And disruption also brings a lot of signals. From my experience, I have seen people sometimes react to the noises, but not recognizing the signals which disruption brings it. I'll share some of the case studies which I faced in my companies, like Toyota, GE, Britannia, as well as CA, and now with the CSE. What is the difference between noise and signals? And how these organizations differentiate noise and signals, and leaders' ability to understand signals. And if you understand the signals, you can prepare very well. But if you react to these noises, maybe you'll get into trouble. So we need to learn, first thing in disruption is what is noise and what is signal. The second one is see the connection, not just the dots. Any disruption brings a pattern. That's what I have learned. These are from my real-time experience I have seen. Any disruption brings a pattern. So one of the biggest challenge of management, when I was a student of management, I studied MSW, Master of Social Work. So first 1 month, we struggled to establish whether management is a science or arts. That was a topic given to us. And we are given a lot of presentation to, among ourselves and to the faculty members. One group of students said management is a science, and one group of students said management is an arts. So finally, we come to the conclusion, management is an arts and science. What characterizes management as a science is three things: ability to understand a phenomena, ability to predict a phenomena, and ability to control a phenomena. If you can do this, you can call it as a science. So as managers, our abilities to understand a phenomena makes us better managers in the world. It can be in HR world an attrition, or in the finance world profitability, or in the sales world our ability to convert pipeline into real term sales. So how do you understand the pattern happening around you in your functional world is the first competency required as managers. You agree? Ability to understand. Second one is, after understanding it, you need to predict it. I understood attrition happening 18%, I understood root causes of attrition, then my challenge is, if the same causes happening in the next 6 months, we land up in 22% attrition. I understood causes of low profitability. If the same situation continues, my year end will end with X number of profitability. So understand and predict is the second competency. Third competency as managers is, I understood, I predicted it. Then third one is, how do I control it? But he cannot be at the mercy of chance. He cannot leave to the chance to control it. So he need to really get in front of the game and control it. So that is reason we call it science. So when it comes to disruption, I have seen, we need to really understand not the dots alone, but the connection alone, and understand, predict. This is, I understood, it's happened in the last 6 months. I have seen last 12 months it happened. But if the same situation continue, I understand the disruption is going to get in this direction. I can be out of business, or I can be in real trouble. And the ability to control it, for that, you can't look at the dots alone. You need to look at the connection between the dots is one of the key competencies in understanding disruption. Make sense? The next one, when you embrace disruption, you need to really take advantage of rapidly changing environment. Always we resist. If you really look at 2 years back or 3 years back, I remember earlier days of management or my experience, the people who disrupt, we'll throw them out. Because none of us want any disruption in the day-to-day life. And we never embraced disruption. We always want stability. Management is for stability. We want management is stability. That was the phenomena. Always we want stability and predictability in management. Now we started embracing disruption. So when once you started embracing disruption, you find a lot of advantage the disruption bring to the business. You started really enjoying the disruption, and once you understand and predict and control, once you learn that, then you really started enjoying and converting disruption into, I'll give some of the examples so that you can connect the dots here. Then you said, I really love it. This disruption is really helping me. And I started taking advantage of the disruption to my business models, and I started getting benefit out these disruptions. You know, Amazon Web Services, they're really one of the fastest growing business models they have. The reason is, they really took the benefit of cloudification to their advantage, and they're really capturing the market, and they started embracing the change, and they really got into this model very well. The next one, we say that once you really size the disruption, your ability to accept it and convert into business model become a culture in your organization. That's what a lot of case studies we can discuss, how these companies took advantage of this. So you really, if you really look at any of these case studies, we get to know there are business models like Kodak. Kodak Moments. Anybody has seen Kodak Moments? What is Kodak Moments? Lessons learned on disruption. Kodak had the IP on digital film or digital camera. They had the IP. They had the IP, but they know the disruption coming from Polaroid and as well as cellular camera to digital, but they were worried about cannibalization of their own revenue. But they did not go for digital camera at that time. They afraid of their own business model changes. As a result, Sony and others took the marketplace and Kodak become a history. So there are many, many such case studies you can see if you look into marketplace. The another interesting case study is Blockbuster. I remember when I was in US, Long Island, I used to go every weekend to take the DVD from Blockbuster. Phenomenal. They had networks in every 3-4 kilometers or miles in US, in certain places. You can collect the DVD and you can return back on the weekend. It was one of the happening, and they grow very fast. But they failed to recognize the internet revolution happening and the options which can come on. People can download movies through internet, and that disruption they failed to recognize. As a result, Blockbuster become irrelevant. So the disruption can come from various aspects. It can come from technology. So when disruption comes to our mind, always we believe it's technology, isn't it? That's the first thing to come to your mind. But it is not true. If you go back into history or what is happening around you, it is not only technology In business models also disruptions are happening and you are facing challenges because of the business models. So I would like to open up and ask you questions. Once we said technology is bringing business disruptions and competition is throwing away. Business models are coming and making competition very tough. What kind of other disruption you see around you? Any other examples of disruption? Technology, business models. Pardon? Uber. Uber is a, like a, we discussed, Suresh mentioned it. It's another excellent, they don't own any of the cars, but they came with an excellent business model. That's a business model and they also use technology to do that. Any other examples comes to your mind? Yeah. Yeah, again, enabled by technology. Yeah. So a lot of online. For example, if you really look at when Apple came with an application on mobile, nobody thought that the opportunities around that. Now everything have a mobile. If you want to go to a hair salon, there is a mobile. If you want to have a nursing, there is a mobile. Everything now, there is a mobile and it is going to be mobile app small. Everything will be, so that has thrown lot of opportunity on business models and change of technology. So one thing I want to drive, it is not only business models and technology, there are many case studies around us. We are going peacefully in our family, sudden death in a family member bring disruption to our family. You agree? Go back into your own family members. I'm very sure many people sitting here, I have gone through in my own personal life, everything was peaceful in the family. Suddenly, death or arrival of a new member or your marriage of your sibling can bring disruption to your life. So illness, everything is going very well. I was reading an article called Voice in the Thin Air. You should read that article. Just note it down, called Voice in the Thin Air. There's an excellent article of a professional who met with a cancer and died at the age of 38. And he narrates the disruption he has gone through in his personal life and how he fought and how he disrupted his family life and personal life. He is beautifully, it's a philosophical book, documented very well. Then Clayton Christensen, he's a professor in Harvard. He has written a book called Innovation Dilemma and many good books he has written. He's a professor who hit with a cancer. When he teaches in the Harvard, he could not see the student's face. He could only bend and teach because of he had a surgery here. And he also returned how disruption impacted his life and how he overcome. So disruption is not only in terms of business model. Disruption is not only in terms of technology. Disruption can come in your personal life and disruption can come through health issues. And many things, then how do you face as a leader and how do you embrace that and how do you change it and overcome? So there are many successful case studies, how people transform themselves. There are many failures, people fail to respond to this is a key message of today's discussion. I'm very sure other panel members will talk more in depth on their own learnings from this disruption, how their organization, how their colleagues, how their competition, how the marketplace embraced this disruption. With that, let me quickly get into a couple of more thoughts. EY, consulting company, has done a research on disruption. So they find over the last many years, the number of articles written or number of case studies written on disruption, you can see 2015 or last five years of block, the number of articles written is almost 10 times than 20 years back on disruption. You can see the chart is shows that number of articles, volume of articles written on disruption. So if you Google it, today you get number of articles on disruption is much higher in volume than 5 years back. That's the chart clearly shows. So that means today we are living in a world of disruption. So I should compliment Suresh for taking this topic. We are living in an era of disruption and our ability to understand, adopt ourselves and prepare ourselves as leaders and prepare our family members and prepare our team members to face this disruption is inevitable. You agree? Okay, now let's quickly get into, I don't know whether you can see the chart. it again talks about where disruption originates. They did a research where the disruption comes and hits people and how people react. I'll quickly walk you through that. I'm not getting into details of this. One is globalization drives disruption and brings a lot of opportunity around globalization. And for example, how globalization is disrupting Indian companies. The latest, I'm very sure Chandan can talk about telecom industry and disruption globalization has created in telecom. Earlier it was very closed industry, now it's opened up, it has gone through many changes for Indian telecom providers, and also Indian telecom providers like Bharati Telecom and everything also went global in Africa and many regions because of the effect of globalization. Now insurance companies. Insurance companies are getting more and more global, and the regulations around insurance is getting diluted or opening up. So globalization, if you as a result, a lot of Indian protected companies, including LIC, is going to get into a bigger problem because of disruption happening around globalization, isn't it? India itself, after 1993, you know that kind of globalization, we faced it, and the opportunities and threat some of the Indian companies faced it because of the globalization. So one point here clearly shows that globalization triggers disruption and brings bundles of opportunity for stronger players and also scares bundles of companies. And globalization also scares individual leaders. Globalization provides a lot of opportunity for managers. And globalization provides bundles of opportunity for young managers in India. I was talking to my colleagues in IBM, HP, Capgemini. Earlier they used to only hire low-end jobs in India. Today they are open up senior leadership team to be hired in India, and they are giving leadership positions in India managing global roles. IBM recently hired 11 people managing global roles out of India for their application business. Is again an impact of globalization. As a result, a lot of senior people in US lost their job. It was a disruption for them, but it was an opportunity for leaders in India. So it gives opportunity for set of people, and also it challenges a set of people. That's a key message, what globalization. So you need to understand the pattern, not the dots. And you need to prepare, understand, predict, and control. What will happen in the near future because of this disruption around globalization is one of our challenge which we need to address. Second one, it talks about technology. We talked enough. Technology is challenging heavily every companies. Even technology industries now from on-premise to cloud is given tons of opportunities for company, and also it made bankrupt many, many great companies which doesn't exist today. We know Nokia, it was one of the household brand in the mobile, today it does not exist. And I can keep on talking about many, many examples in the technology space, how technology had made a lot of companies bankrupt and how it has given opportunities for many, many companies to become, as well as how it created leadership competencies for many, many players. The last one is demography, workforce demography. Workforce demography also is disrupting the workplace and disrupting the business models. Can anybody tell me what is workforce demography is disrupting the business models? Pardon? I know it's afternoon, it's a little tough. Yeah, any example of how workforce demography is disrupting the business models or disrupting the environment? Yeah. Yeah. Very good. So at a time, four generations are working, and today we have a lot of millennial workers are available in the marketplace, and their thinking, their ability to respond, their workforce behavior, and the demography of consumer behavior. For example, have you ever thought lot of online retail, why it is successful? One is technology. What is another reason? Pardon? It's a demography. Lot of people, youngsters now like online shopping, isn't it? They don't want to go to the, my son and daughter loves online shopping. One is they're lazy. I said, let's go and shop it in Shopper Stop or something. He said, Dad, I don't want to come. They want to shop it in online. So the demography is changing the consumer behavior and it is disrupting the retail entire network. So another example I'll tell you. Earlier, you talked about qualification. The PhDs in IIT, or that's changing. I agree. Another reverse is happening. In IT world, 5 years back, we hire maximum qualification to do a job. We used to say that, why can't I hire an MBA to do a software engineering or certain jobs, and because they are available in India and it's not costly. Today, thinking is different. We go for minimum denominator, not maximum denominator. We said certain jobs require only physics, chemistry, we call STEM students, or diploma. Why should we require engineers? Why should we require MBAs? I want only diploma student or science students. We hire 50% of jobs earlier done by engineers by today by physics, chemistry and diploma students. We don't want them and we pay half of the salary what we used to pay for engineering students. And the reverse trend is happening and we call it as pyramid management. Quality of pyramid management is changing. Then we provide them career opportunity to learn engineering and MBA while they do the job. And we hold them for a longer time. And we, so a lot of interesting things are happening in the consumer side, in employment side, because of the workforce demography and disruption around that. So I thought I'll categorize. Interest of time, I just want to quickly give you some of the mega trends. I'm not getting into each one of it. Some of the mega trends here. One is industry is redefined, we discussed. Then future of smart, I don't know how many of you understand. Alphabet, that is Google. Google is experimenting self-driven vehicle in US. Isn't it? And they already successfully tested it. And there are miles and miles testing is completed in cities like Manhattan. Where one of the, if anybody have driven in Manhattan, it's like Bombay city. Of course, Manhattan is more disciplined than Bombay. There they are experienced, have they piloted and tested successfully millions of miles, they have successfully completed it. So that is going to disrupt the entire, going forward, technology as well as opportunity what it brings to the industry. I'm not getting the last one, I just interest of time, health. When we did a sales conference in Orlando, we had a panel discussion. So we work with a company called Kaiser Permanente. They are one of the health providers in East West Coast, California. So we had a doctor's panel. So one of the doctor was telling they are experimenting. They are in the final stage. They are waiting for US authorities approval. By 2020, we will have 20 billion devices in the world. 20 billion devices. 5 times greater than what we have. Today we have 5 billion devices. Devices like mobile phone, laptops, RFID tag what you wear for the dog, all these are devices. But we will have by 2020, 20 billion devices. And all these devices will be connected through internet. And these devices will generate data. And that will disrupt the entire marketplace. So one of the example he was, doctor was telling, they are in the final stage of approval, they are going to inject a platelet. It's a small, like a red blood corpuscles or a white blood corpuscles. That size, but it's a device they'll inject into the blood. And that device will send your diabetes measures, your blood pressure measures, and also it can detect cancer and other measures, and it will send signals to the doctor in doctor's laptop. So that will disrupt a lot of healthcare scenarios. So what will happen? Most of the labs, testing labs will go bankrupt. They don't want. We don't want testing labs today. We not inject, we not take out the blood and test it, isn't it? We not do that because it is automatically send signals to the doctor's laptop. Then doctors will call you, say, hey, I got a signal from your body saying that your blood pressure is high or your diabetes is very high, and come and take the treatment or get admitted. So they have demonstrated they are in the final stage of approval. So that is the disruption going to happen in the marketplace because of the Internet of Things and connected devices, which is going to revolutionize the marketplace. So I will take next 2 minutes to really talk about, in that disruptive behavior, there was a research conducted, what should be human behavior to understand and predict and control. Then Chandan, I'll hand it over to you. So a research was conducted in disruptive environment, what kind of behavior we need to demonstrate as leaders. Who will survive? We are given various scenarios of disruption: technology, globalization, workforce demography. It can be at a personal level, it can be at an organizational level. What kind of behavior you need to demonstrate as leaders to face disruption? Are you with me? Why can't you stand up for a minute, because this is very important. Stand up, then you can, I know some of you are just closing your eyes. Everybody. Okay, thank you. Are you okay? Okay. So the point of departure we had is, we are telling disruption is given, nobody can run away. You have to only embrace it and work towards it. That's a key message, isn't it? Then we are telling, we have seen disruption happening in our own family life, our own personal life. We have seen disruption happening in organization through technology, business models, various things we have seen it. There are a lot of successful case studies who overcome disruption, who predicted and embraced disruption. There are studies available who failed and disappeared. Now the same study shows that there are 5 R's. The capital R, the alphabet R, is essential to really be smart and overcome disruption. The first one, the successful organization and leaders demonstrated the first R called relevance. They always want to be relevant in the marketplace which they served. So that is very important for to be surviving in disruptive world. So what do you mean by relevance? Because it's very important, let us spend a few minutes. What do you mean by relevance? What's the importance of relevance in disruption? What's the importance of relevance in disruption? Yeah. So as leaders and your organization, you need to always, your challenge is, how can I be relevant in the marketplace to my customers? How can I be, as a leader, be relevant in the today's context so that I can overcome this disruption? So you need to always, your challenge is keep yourself relevant. So from the leadership perspective, your constant challenge is understand the changes happening around you and upgrade your skills, upgrade your competency, upgrade your capacity, and you need to be agile so that you can be relevant. When the disruption happens, you are ready to face it and embrace it. So you need to always ask the question, not only how and when, but why. The people who always work on why create relevance in the marketplace. I will send you many case studies which companies use relevance, asking why we should do it for customers and shareholders, overcome the disruption very well. Excellent case study called Umbeck Bank in America. They always used the relevance of questions called why we should exist in this marketplace, and trained managers and leaders to be relevant in the marketplace is very, very important. Second one, the leaders need to be responsive. If you want to face disruption, you need to be responsive. What do you mean by responsive? Pardon? You are not reacting. And if you are reacting, you will regret. Responsive means you are accountable. And second dimension of responsiveness, if it takes, it's called clock time. If it takes 2 days by your competition, can you do it in 2 hours? That means speed, the velocity is a dimension of responsiveness, which is very, very important to face disruption. The companies, there are many case studies shows the companies overcome disruption, or leaders who overcome disruption are responsive. They are not late in responding. They responded very fast. I told you the case study of Kodak. Kodak was not responsive to the marketplace. Blockbuster was not responsive to the marketplace. They are slow in reaction and they are not accountable. They are reacted to the marketplace. As a result, they become irrelevant. I can tell you many case studies of leaders who are not responsive to the needs of the environment. They become irrelevant in the marketplace. The third one is called resilience. If you want to face disruption, you should be resilient. What do you mean by resilience? Pardon? You never give up. In the disruptive world, you sometimes you stand up and face the challenge, you get hit by the people. But you again stand up. You said, I'm not going to give up. I may not win the first time, but I am going to give my best shot and get up every time when I get beaten up in the disruptive world. I know it's not easy as a leader to survive. Even there are many cancer patients who faced, they know that the drug is not responding. I am not going to give up. Even people who have gone through their personal difficulties, they know that it's not easy to get up and run. They don't give up. They are resilient like a rubber band. They have stretched themselves, but they don't lose their tenacity and shape and size. Resilience is enough important for disruption. The next one is resourcefulness. In order to face disruption, you should be resourceful. Resourceful is not plenty of resources. Resourcefulness means you may have very little, but you know how to use it. Like all startup companies have very little resources, but they are very resourceful. But they use their resources to the maximum efficiency. In disruption, resourcefulness is very, very important. Otherwise, you will be thrown out of the competition. How do you can be resourceful? The last one is for disruption, in order to trigger disruption, as well as in order to face disruption, you need to be reflective. What do you mean by reflective? Pardon? Reflective means there's a tendency in agile world, there's a definition in agile world called fail fast and recover fast. And when you fail fast and recover fast, you learn fast and be reflective on how did you fail, what made you to fail. Looking at the mirror like a driving, the way you came, review yourself, what made me to fail, what made me to successful. So reflection is looking back. So in reflection, the article talks about disruptive companies fail fast. But a lot of people even hate to fail, isn't it? We'll cover up our failures and we don't learn from failures. All the case studies of disruption shows that they failed fast and they learned from the failure and they recovered very fast from the failure. But other companies, they postponed their failure, they were not willing to fail and they refused to fail. As a result, they never reflected themselves. So an excellent framework, the building the relational web to face disruption. There are case studies for each one. Sony Ericsson on resilience. UPS, UPS is a company, United Postal Services in US, is a logistics company. They are known for resourcefulness. 4 lakhs employees globally, 8 billion parcels they serve, most resourceful company in the world. A case study on that. So each one, there are case studies how this company faced disruption and overcome. Based on that, they come up with a model. So that's what I want to leave behind it. Thank you very much. Chandan, I know I took a little more time. I thought I'll set the context. So I'll request you to share your journey and how you overcome disruption and prepared your organization. Thank you.
Can I have these lights on, please?
Yeah, you can take these lights also.
Thank you. Good afternoon to all of you. First of all, thank you very much, Sri Balaji Society, for getting me back after 10 years. It's a real pleasure to be here. I met Dr. Bala a while back. No, I don't need. I think I'm... Thank you. I don't need a lot. Do I need a caller mic? Thank you. Great. So I met Dr. Bala as well, and it is a real pleasure to meet him after 2008. I had met him when I used to work for the Oberoi Group. So thank you very much. Before I talk about disruption, I need to set the context for the organization and the organization that I represent. I work for UFlex, which is the largest flexible packaging company in India. We have our operations in India, but we also have our manufacturing locations in Dubai, Egypt, Mexico, Poland, US, and Kenya. We roughly have about 8,000 people, and at some locations, for example, in Egypt, we have 3 manufacturing locations. In Dubai, we have 2 manufacturing locations. And talking of disruption, I'll talk about it in a bit. But the interesting fact is that while we talk of disruption, and you know that we have been leaders in flexible packaging, but the fact of the matter is that when it comes to liquid packaging, Tetra Pak is the big daddy. And we are now getting into Tetra Pak, liquid packaging for that matter. We are setting up our plant at a place called Sanand in Gujarat. And we would be the first Indian company ever to take on Tetra Pak, which today has 90 to 95% market share globally. You know, when you talk about disruption, I remember the musician Frank Zappa, who said, "You can't have progress unless you deviate." And I want to share a very interesting story about disruption. But before that, let me ask you, can you tell me what's the Hindi equivalent of disruption? Aap mere ko Hindi mein bata sakte ho? What does disruption in Hindi? Sorry? Kranti? Manoj Kumar wali? Sorry, Vinash? Are you Googling at this point in time? Okay, so I will give you, you're actually bang on, so I will give you some of them. It talks about Bighatan, Bhang, Biched, Vidaran, Durghatna, Lop, Fatan. Now, you know, when you listen to these words, they are absolutely scary. And then you start thinking that when we all talk of disruption today and we think that it's a great thing to happen in an organization or companies or sometimes even at homes, how is it going to help the business? So let me explain to you with a story. I used to work for the Oberoi Group at one point in time. And one afternoon, we had a meeting with Mr. P.R.S. Oberoi, and there came a suggestion that we need to go away and create something, an experience for people which is absolutely untold. It's an untold story. So can you think of something? Long story short, that's when the concept of Vilases came in. If you have heard about Uday Vilas in Udaipur, Raj Vilas in Jaipur, Amar Vilas in Agra, Vanya Vilas in Ranthambore, or for that matter, any of the Vilas properties, it was completely unthinkable that someone can create a property at that level. So people started asking within the organization that, are we not, you know, sinking money in? You know, who is going to spend money? Who is going to come and stay in those hotels, in those villas? But it was time. And that is what is the difference between a leader and a disruptive leader. Because there was no point being the biggest. It was important to be the best. And how do you create the best? You can't just compete on a 5-star category or a 7-star category. So you had to create something which will disrupt the market. Rest is history. Today, if you look up, you will find some of these hotels or some of these villas in the top 10 in the world. But when you think of the disruption which was created at that point in time within the organization, taking people along, convincing them that this is a story which could create a class of its own when it came to hospitality was not easy. But I must share a very interesting story at this point in time, that what can disruption lead to. You know, it was one of the afternoon and Mr. Oberoi was visiting Uday Villas in Udaipur. The construction work was in full swing. And he was very, very particular in way things need to happen. And so he had shared with his team, project team, how a room of Uday Villas should look like. So a room was built, you know, a model room is always built before the actual property comes up. So a room was built and we were there to see that room. Mr. Oberoi was in the front, we were all following him. And he walks into a room, he looks at the room and he goes, you know, what is this? I had not prescribed this. I had selected some other color. Why have you put this color on the wall? Everybody looked at each other. They said, my God, I thought this was these were the specs which were given to us. We had one lady amongst us who had the courage which we didn't have. He told Mr. Oberoi, Mr. Oberoi, I think you need to take those colored glasses out. Because Mr. Oberoi had come out of his car and he was still wearing his tinkered glasses. And he had walked into the model room with his sunglasses on. So since he had his sunglasses on, his colors that he looked at the wall were looking very different. So somebody had the guts to tell him. So that's when he took off his glasses and he put his normal glasses on. And then he found, okay, so these were the colors which he had prescribed. Now sometimes, when you talk about disruption, it can go to this extent that sometimes you don't even ask a disruptive leader, hame chalna kahan hai? Which way are we going? But there are always a few people within the room who'd ask such questions. We talk about disruption. Now people or leaders who talk about disruption and who create disruption, think about Steve Jobs and Apple. You can't get a better example than that. 2005, 25 million iPods were sold. I'm sure you were not in the generation of MP3s that was left for us and the group. And we could never think that MP3 could be replaced, you know. But the fact of the matter is, he had seen it coming. He had seen music coming on phone. And that's when iPod, MP3 were gone. And that's when we saw Apple iPhone. And today, it's a success story. Now, why do you think Steve Jobs was able to do that? Because he was a leader who had intellectual curiosity. He was a leader who could think beyond the normal. When you deviate from the normal and you want to deviate from the normal, that's when you become disruptive. And to do that, you need some bit of curiosity. And it's not only about simple curiosity, you need intellectual curiosity. He was also a leader who was fiercely competitive. If you read his autobiography, you will find many, many stories where he has been leaving the office, walking into a lift, he meets people, he asks them, what have you done for the day? And if he's not satisfied, he will send them back. Because he was preparing his team, his organization, for a long haul. So you have to be fiercely competitive. And you need to be a thick skin. Because diamonds get polished over a period of time. So when you are disruptive, you will face criticism. You will face people who think, what are you doing? Let me share another story with you. You have heard or seen or lived at the Oberoi Mumbai at the Nariman Point, or Trident at the Nariman Point. When this iconic hotel was being built, it was a swash land, you know, opposite the Marine Drive. And when Mr. P.R.S. Oberoi thought of buying that land and creating a property, because till then he had not done anything in his life, okay? So Rai Bahadur came up and said, what are you doing? You are investing into something which is never going to give you return. But that was one decision where Mr. P.R.S. Oberoi said, I need to take this call and allow me to take this call. If you read the book, Dare to Dream, you will find these stories. So this is where he was allowed to live his dream. And that was the first property that Mr. Oberoi ever built, and rest is history. I've heard he also talked about Kodak and Kodak moments. I was a part of Xerox when Xerox was going through the transformation. It used to be Modi Xerox in India. That was the time in 2004 when Modi's were just leaving out, and Xerox 100% in India was taken over by Xerox Stanford. Very, very difficult moments in life. And we talk of disruption. Xerox was a name which was known to everybody. You talk about, say, agar aapko photocopy karni hai, aap kehte ho Xerox karke lao. If you give your guy who works at home, if you tell him, can you get a Xerox done, aap ek Xerox karwa doge, he doesn't need an explanation, right? But the fact of the matter is, Xerox has always been known for a company selling boxes. And Xerox wanted to move away from that piece of understanding. And that's when they created a business called Xerox Global Services. I would urge you to read a story of the succession plan between Anne Mulcahy and Ursula Burns. Anne, I had worked during the regime of Anne, who was the CEO, global CEO of Xerox. There is a great succession plan story between Anne Mulcahy and Ursula Burns. One came from marketing, one came from manufacturing. And what happens when two leaders meet who are from different spaces, but the story is about disruption. So Xerox wanted to transform from being a dabba chewing company to a company which was into digitization. So they got into a business called Xerox Global Services, where they could digitize any and every piece of document. They have been trying to do this, especially in Asia Pac, for a very, very long time. They wanted to be a disruptive leader. Their R&D center in Rochester is to be seen to be believed. But the fact of the matter is, the challenge is between being disruptive, but creating that product and bringing in with a great execution. If you don't bring in with a great execution, sometimes disruptions can really hit you on your face. You talk about telecom. I am sure many of you remember that ad of Mahendra Singh Dhoni. He was the Indian captain, both for tests and 20s and one days. And Aircel had come with an ad of Dhoni that five of his friends, you are going out, you can go on your phone, you can book a hotel, you can pay online, I can do a lot of stuff. Now in telecom, those are called value-added products. The challenge was, since Aircel entry into India was late, it had a lot of history, a lot of baggage, They were already formative players who were already at market shares. So Airtel was branded as a young, funky organization with value-added products which could connect with the youth. A great idea for disruption. But you know what the issue was? The issue was, it was ahead of its time. So even today, we talk about paying online. The Indian mindset is still to accept that is paying online safe? Will it work? How does it work if it works? But a lot of money, lot of energy, lot of enthusiasm was spent around creating that atmosphere in this country that telecom can create a lot of change and disruption amongst the youth. I love telling stories. And stories are great healers. They tell you that what disruption can do and what disruption cannot do. You know, disruptive leaders, they're relentless on pursuit of truth. They are extremely decisive. They are great guides in times of change and when situations are chaotic. They are not threatened by uncertainties. And also, they break rules which are normal. Let me give you an example of what's happening in the Indian market space, because as Uflex, we say we are a part of your daily life. So the Lay's chips that you eat, that packaging is made by us. The Nestle, you know, Maggie that you eat, again, that packaging is made by us. And you know the Maggie story, what has happened with Maggie in the last 2 years. You've read about that?
Yes, sir.
Right, great. So there was a lot of hullabaloo around Maggie. It got banned state-wise, then it got banned across. It went on for 8-9 months, but then they came back. Now when they came back, we always do packaging for Maggie. So they wanted from us something which would be a differentiator on the shelf. They wanted to bring in a product which would create, you know what? It could create faith in the customer. In India or across, counterfeit is a great challenge. But they also had a competition. Because by the time they came back after 8-9 months with their new evolution of Maggi and the packaging and everything, Patanjali was already in place. They had already come up with their brand of Maggi. Today, if you follow Patanjali, it is actually a great disruptor. Okay? So there was a lot of discussion which went on behind scenes that what is it that we can do, which we can create that brand value for Maggi. And today, the good news is, it's actually back on the shelf and it's kicking. So disruptions can happen both ways. It is not only the business. Even HR has a very, very important role to play when we talk about disruptions. If we look at an HR strategy, the HR strategy at any point of time has to be in sync with the business strategy. Since we operate multi-location, my colleagues will tell you, we cannot afford to have the same strategy everywhere. So if we have a strategy for India, our strategy for disruption in Egypt could be very, very different. Since we are late entrants to these markets, whether it is Egypt, whether it is Mexico, whether it is Kentucky, our disruption strategy has to be different. It has to be country specific. It also has to be seen that if we are putting up a plant in Elizabethtown and we are trying to compete with multinationals in America, especially North America, there are three things you need to be sure about: your product, quality, and service. If you can't beat on them, your disruption will go for a toss. So while pricing is important, it is extremely crucial that these three things are absolutely in shape. We, in UFlex, we serve all kinds of customers. We serve multinationals also. At the same time, we serve a customer like Haldiram as well. Now today, if you go to US and you go to a superstore, you will actually see Haldiram products. But how do those products survive in that market? This, because it's absolutely about longevity, it's absolutely about freshness. How do you do that? It can only happen when you have a packaging which is an answer in that market. Today we have created a product or flower wrap. It looks very simple. But the fact of the matter is, flowers are grown in parts of Africa. They are, through distribution channel, they're sent to Amsterdam. That's the distribution center. And then they get distributed worldwide. Now we have come up with a packaging, and if you use that, I don't know how many of you are on Twitter. How many of you are on Twitter? Can you give your hands up? Oh, wow. So you can actually go to Twitter, follow UFlex, and see, I didn't know about it, I just saw it about 2 hours back, that we have come up with a packaging which will keep papayas globally eatable and fresh for a period of 2 weeks. Okay? Similarly, flowers, the flower wrap that I'm talking about, will keep flowers as fresh as you see them in Amsterdam for a period of 2 weeks. Now these are disruptions, you know. These are disruptions because of the simple fact that every customer wants something new. They want to see that what is it that you can create, because everybody is competing. Everybody is competing with each other. We supply to Patanjali also, we supply to Nestle also. But each one of them have their own way of looking at the market. And they have their own disruption strategy. So everybody is disrupting, you know. But it's about whose disruption will actually work. Finally, I just want to close by saying that disruption is a part of life, you know. It's you like it or you don't like it. It's a part of life. It has to come. It will come. And it is any geography. Since we work in multi-geographical locations, while we manage one disruption here today, we find another disruption has happened somewhere else. So this is a part of life. The faster we embrace it, the better off we will be. And the best part of life is enjoy the disruptions. It will take you a notch higher. Thank you very much.
Okay. Chandan, thank you very much. I think Chandan deserves much better applaud. That energy is not. Thank you. Thank you. Hey, Chandan, extremely useful. I have noted some of the key takeaway. So, but let us hear from some of our audience. Then I will go to Sharmila and Sapna. I have a few questions from which triggered some thoughts from Chandan. Before that, let's take some of the key takeaway. When you walk out of the room, what are few things triggered your thought and you are going to do something differently after this, after listening to Chandan? Any volunteers? I will share. I have a few things which I have noted I'm going to do differently, which really registered my mind. Yeah. Any volunteers? Yeah. Yeah, go ahead. We can. Yeah, we could hear. Go ahead. Yeah.
Thank you, Parag. Have a seat. Please sit down. Okay, couple of things. I'll come to Maggie later. First of all, I'm very confident, I'm very sure, and I'm very clear that disruption does not happen by accident. Today, every customer, every challenger in the market prepares for disruption, is only working for disruption. Okay? Now, if you want to work around disruption, you have to create a team. So today, if we produce films, and we produce films for flexible packaging, we are in a state of war all the time. So we have a team which only works on innovation. So we have a team in US and we have a team in India. They work together because every 2 months they need to come out with a product, you know, and these products are based on microns, 8 microns, 10 microns, 14 microns, 28 microns. But their only job is how do you disrupt the market with a new product all the time? Number one. Coming to Maggi, I may not be able to share too much details because of confidentiality. First of all, let me tell you, when this was being worked, I was sharing with him. I was not a part of the team. Some of us were not even allowed to enter the plant where this was being manufactured. It was so confidential, okay? But I can share with you that today, we are a very strong organization when it comes to holographic products, okay? You have heard about holograms. Okay, so today we have come out with a product which are small patches of holograms which you can inscribe on a product. Okay, for example, if you are buying a packet of Marlboro, whether you buy it in Shanghai or you buy it in Delhi, how do you know it is actually genuine? It's very difficult. Okay. So I can give you upteen examples. You buy a packet of Pepsodent. You buy it in Pune or you buy it in Delhi. You don't know it is original or not. You only know it is Pepsodent. So we have come up with products, and that's where the Maggi story revolves, which will prove the genuineness of that product, which at least now, till now, nobody else has this product. So that is what we have come up when it comes to hologram. You talk of disruptiveness. Let me just share with you just 2 seconds. Holograph and cylinders are two products of flexible packaging. And they were a part of the flexible packaging business till about a few years back. We took those chunks out, we created them as new divisions. And today, while flexible packaging is about 1600 crores, hologram is already 400 crores. And cylinders by itself is about 350 crores. So you see, when you want to disrupt the market, he was talking about more business models, you have to tweak the business models as well. That's what we have been trying to do.
Yeah. Chandan, thank you very much. I'm tempted with sharing another case study. As you rightly said, we either trigger disruption or we face disruption. Isn't it? Either we voluntarily trigger disruption because it is required, or we face disruption. But in either situation, the leadership responsibility, the responsiveness that you see, there's an interesting case today I would like to share of two companies. Both of them made mistake, but the responsiveness was different. One company, I don't know, if you Google it, you'll find that case study called Jack on the Box or In the Box, I don't exactly. It's a company who are like McDonald's, it's a famous restaurant chains in US. So they were caught by a food poison which happened in Americas. So Jack on the Box company, what they did it, they blamed the meat supplier, saying that they supplied wrong meat to us. They did not take the accountability what happened on that food chain disruption, or the mistake happened in the poison. But the meat supplier said, no, we supplied very rightly. We clearly specified Jack on the Box to cook it in a certain temperature. They did not do it. As a result, the poison created. So both of them blamed each other, did not take an accountability. As a result, Jack on the Box is a history. The company went bankrupt. It got disrupted. They made a mistake. But the responsiveness, what you see, they are not responsive enough to the customers, did not take the mistake. Another case study is Tylenol, the medicine. Those who are in US, you know, like our Crozin or Brufen. It's a medicine box you will see. What is speciality of that box, you know? It comes in a small plastic bottle. It have a lock It's called the Telenor lock. What it happens, if you keep on rotating, you cannot open the box. But there is an arrow in the box. It has to come in a particular direction, then only the box would get opened. The history of that box is they also had a problem. The medicine were supplied vastly in Americas. So as a result, you know, the lock had a problem and some people consumed it wrongly. And there was a legal suit filed against the company. And the share price dropped significantly. Their revenue dropped less than $80 million in a particular month. But the company could have irresponsible, or the responsiveness could have been negative. But the CEO came out and said, I take personal accountability. It is a mistake. We could have been more responsible because we are dealing with a drug. Give us a 1 month, we'll come up with a solution. They innovated that bottle lock. That was a famous innovation. They did it. Every company replicated it. They admitted it was a mistake. But the customers pardoned them. Next month, the revenue went 3 times of that company because the company was responsive and the market price went 2 times. So the key learning, the disruption can happen in your business model. You can make mistake, but how you respond to the market condition as a responsive leader, as an organization, is very, very important. So that's a case study. They talk about it. I think when you talk about Nestle or noodles, how the company was responsive to respond to the marketplace is very, very important when you face disruption. Make sense? Okay. Now, Shamil, you know, we are very curious.
Excuse me, sir.
You have been working as a business leader.
Excuse me.
You have been advising in the board. So you have been seeing a lot of disruption happening in the marketplace. So we'd like to know from what kind of leadership behavior or how companies react to this disruption. If you can share some of your thoughts and experience, that will be great value for us.
Good evening, good afternoon. And so we are all going to be listening now. We start with a hi, hello. I say hi and you guys say hello. So I know all of you are awake. Hi.
Hello.
You're awake. Okay. I am a living example of disruption. When I say living example, I'm in a field of logistics which is totally male dominated. And being the only woman coming into it, first of all, when you enter a boardroom or even enter into a business company, you know, they say, my gosh, they've got somebody who's not in the, you know, they've got something wrong here. Only when you sit down and actually see, it's been a very tough journey, long journey. And as I rightly said, it has to be about you. It has to be about what you want to do. It's about how you assert yourself and put yourself forward. And that's what I aimed and aspired to be, and today that's what where I am standing today. Now, how many of you are now talking and sitting and aware that the change in disruption, as you rightly say, is going to be a big game changer with the GST coming into force for all of us? We are one of the largest spenders of logistics in the world. Our cost of logistics for movement is more than 20%, whereas against 8% anywhere in the world. So if I talk about having, let's say, a packet of Maggie, as you would rightly say, moved from the factory to another location, the cost of logistics movement itself kills the price, which is not what would happen anywhere. So disruptions of so many kinds are happening. When this logistics industry came to India, there were no foreign companies. All of them were partners with somebody in India. Take a living example of DHL. It came into India as a courier company, which was not, as people assume, the name is called Document Handling Limited. It was the name of three people in America called Derry, Harry, and Lee. At some point of time, the Germans decided that they should buy it. So then it became Deutsche Post, DHL. DHL then realized that just being a document handling company, they were not going to go anywhere in the world. They looked at the model of what happened in a country like India, which was huge for them, and they made so much of money here, they started buying logistics company. They bought one, they bought two, they bought three, and today they're the market leaders. So from an American company, it became a German company, and it's a leader. Today in India, you will not find a single Indian company which has scaled those levels of logistics. We are still dominated by the top floor global players, which is DHL, Kuehne+Nagel, Panalpina. So we have the two Swiss and you have the two Germans. Again, the two Germans are the German post office and the German railways. And the two Swiss are the two Swiss who are ruling the world with they move the world's chocolates and they move the world's medicines and they move the world's flowers. You know, as you rightly said, the flower packing for tulips is moved by these kinds of companies. So we really are talking about disruptions which all of us cannot even imagine. We were all working for Indian companies. Now we are sitting on the other side of the table working for the same MNCs in our own country. When these companies came to India, they were all expats. Not a single of these companies had Indians. And today the disruption is that most of them have the top leaders as Indians. I myself am a living example. Mine is a German company. And when they first started in India, we had a German gentleman. And I have taken over. And so now you can see how the disruption will happen. So basically, I'm so glad to see so many, 50% of the management students here, I'm told, are ladies here. And I was just talking to the lady who writes the magazine. And when you say behind every successful man there is a woman, for me, I think it's the men. So if you guys had not encouraged me, I would not be here today. So so please learn to respect our ladies or our women in this country, because we need you guys as much as you need us. And it's part of my successes, as I said, both of it.
Hey, I have two more questions. Since you are in the board, one of the topic in many of the boards or a board of governance is preparing the organization from the risk perspective. So board keep on asking the operating team, do you understand various risks coming from various dimensions? Financial risk, the compliance risk, and the risk is a topic of what you call it as a disruption. So what kind of discussion you have in the boardroom on disruption? How will you caution the leadership team, operating team? What are the tools and methodology you expect the operating team to really come with, risk and compliance and disruption? That topic, can you just throw some of the lights from your experience? Yeah.
Okay, so I'm on the board of directors of a listed company called Hindustan Oil Exploration. It's the first private oil and gas company in the country, started by Mr. Deepak Parekh's father. And it's part of the compliance and nomination committee. And as per the board rule, is an independent women director. Now, coming to compliance, it's a very, very broad perspective. We at the top level may not make the mistake. We have all the possible caps in place, but still, we have this compliance issue. India still is not on that level, but I think the government has now passed a law that we have to be compliant. Now, compliance does not necessarily mean doing business the right way. Compliance also, to a big extent, is called bribery, and lots of those bigger issues also which happen in this industry. So it's part of a compliance issue. How do we overcome it? Well, we have systems in place to overcome it, but still there are, you know, ways and means to bypass those systems. And you never know. So as a leader, we really do not expect the people that we have down the line to go beyond those so-called lines of compliance. But, you know, you always have a black sheep in every family or every company or every organization. But the law is so strict now, it's not just organizations which have to pay the fine and penalty, but it's now gone to the extent of even being arrested. So this compliance has now gone so strict even in India that if anybody does these kinds of things, it's a non-bailable offense also. And of course, as a board, we are responsible. And so we have to be double sure before we sign any paper or we take on any kind of risk of that we're talking about. As you rightly said, financial risks, yes, we don't know what we are in for, but we still see those still happening a lot of time. You know, doing business itself, now, let's not take examples of anybody, but you can see, imagine, we are on that side of the table. We are not talking about Mr. Malia's risk of taking the money from the bank. But look at freight forwarding companies. We do business with lots of companies who don't pay us till 120 days after you deliver cargo. Yeah. And now what are we doing? All the power projects in the company are on hold from the past 4 years. Add 3 more years, so it's 7 years. You haven't been paid. What do you do? There is no law in this country to take these to court. Even if you do, you spend another 10 years in court. So what is the risk? How do you overcome this? You just have to be extra cautious how you deal with them. Who expected companies not to have money? Who expected companies to become bust and bankrupt? We are in an absolutely disruptive age, as I would put it. So it's just the leadership at the top level, how you manage this, how you overcome it, how you take the risks into factor before signing on a single document is what is going to be the game changer in the future.
I have one question, but you answer it after I come back from Sapna, but you can think about it. You worked in different culture. Now your headquarters is in Germany, but you operate from India. So from cultural differences, I have seen different culture handle disruption differently. So just to share your experience working at German headquarters in Indian workforce here, how culture react to disruption differently. So we'll come back to you, think about it. So Sapna, question to you, two questions to you. The first one is, you worked in big companies like CA, Satyam. Now you are working for a small product company. Is size matters in managing disruption? The big companies think differently in managing disruption, or they react differently. I have seen like GE, Toyota, their ability to manage disruption is different. Small companies think and act differently managing disruption. So can you give, compare and contrast, what is your experience of managing disruption with some examples if you can? That will be great.
Happy that the co-panelists have said, you know, shared their experiences from their own industry and their own roles that they have played so far. So I come from while this was going on, I was thinking like disruption can start from home. There are stories where the personal disruptions give people to come up. Or, it's a challenging situation, like, Dr. Suresh has rightly said, either they run away or, they face and they challenge the situation. So there one story which was like, got registered in my mind. There was a small kid who was going to play, football, and his father used to take him daily. And, one day this person, this boy, he was not playing so well. And one day the boy came and he was extremely playing so good, and everybody were so, praising this boy. And they were asking, what was the reason? We have seen you playing from so many years, but we didn't see this talent in you so far. So the boy gave an answer which was so touching. He says that, all these days my father was bringing me to play this game, but my father was sitting in the audience. And he's a blind person. He couldn't see me play, but now he passed away. And I'm thinking that he is watching me, because they say once you go to heaven, people can watch, and so that's the reason this is my talent. So the disruption can be a good reasons. So I have gone through some personal life disruptions which made me a stronger lady. And definitely, looking at the kind of family I'm brought up, it's not that girls are upfront in the society and all, but definitely, the disruptions which I have faced made me a strong lady. And, I'm proud that, I faced the challenge, and, I'm sitting here on this dais so that I can be of giving some evoking thought in you guys who are going to, bring the industry more into, advanced, the world. Okay, coming to the question that...
Hey, Sapna, 1 minute, hang on, and Chandan need to leave now. So, Chandan, thank you very much, very thought-provoking. So, thank you very much for joining us. Yeah.
Nice meeting you, Chandan.
Thank you very much. Keep in touch. Yeah, thanks.
May I request Professor D.S. Kadam, Projector. May I request Director B.S. Kadam, Director Projects and Alumni Affairs, to present the guest with a token of love and affection.
So, we'll continue. Sharmila, you're okay? Another 10, 15 minutes? Okay. Yeah, yeah. Sure. Come. Yeah. Thank you. Come. Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, you can sit. So, the question back to Sapna is, you know, does the size matters? The ability to trigger disruption and manage disruption, some big companies find it very difficult and some big companies find it very easy. Some small companies find it difficult, or does size matters? That's the question. Yeah.
Yeah, the question is, you know, very apt, because I work for the companies like Satyam, where, you know, it is like around 40,000 employees. Now the company that I'm working, Magnitude, is around 170 employees. So the disruption that, you know, I'll tell you a small story about Magnitude. We started off as a Noetics. That's the, you know, the company which we started 20 years back in US and 10 years in India. So the disruption happened only after 20 years and 10 years in India, that, you know, the culture and the comfort that the employees were enjoying for the 20 years and 10 years was one day got disrupted with a kind of an acquisition. So, you know, it was a disruption where, you know, the company got sold out, and the employees, a couple of them were like, you know, not taking it in a right sense. So that disruption was really a big shock to the management and also to the employees. Definitely, you know, that brought people to understand it's not the comfort zone. You will always to be, you know, on top of everything. You need to upgrade your skills. You need to be like, you know, the key contributor on the organizations. So it's like, you know, it brought all the people from the comfort zone to a very challenging mode. And it became, you know, the people who left also got to understand, or, you know, the people who continued. It's a kind of a good thing that you all get so relaxed, you know, something disruptive should happen where you will get back to your, you know, the talent mode, and, you know, you keep it on top of everything.
Okay, so, yeah. Thanks. So how many of you are doing HR course here? Please raise your hand. HR? No HR here. Okay, so one day you become people manager, your job is to really manage people. So as a people manager, how many of you are aspiring to become a people manager? You're telling, I want to manage people as a sales head or a business head, or like Sharmila, you may be spending a lot of time meeting people, talking to them, isn't it? I spend, as a managing director, at least I spend 60 to 70% of my time meeting people one-on-one, round table, town halls like this. It's all people business. So how many of you like to be in people business? I mean, meeting people, majority of us, okay. So my question again, back to you know, one of the component of people management is coaching and teaching people. So you spend a lot of time listening to people, personal challenges. So when I get into conversation with the people, it may start with the business. Sometime I have to listen to their personal stories. It may be one of the employees say, my son is not doing well, or sometime one employee say, I have my ailing father or father-in-law, or somebody say, look, I'm going through a trouble in relationship. So all these kind of stories come. So when you face disruption, I have seen, you have to really talk to people and manage change at individual level, like one-on-one coaching, or at a group level, communicating the vision and mission of the company or a strategy of the company, and appeal to people, support on your strategy. A lot of convincing you have to do it. So your question back to you is, you as an HR person might have listened to many people who are really struggling to manage disruption, either at their family level or at the organizational level. So from your experience, what are the qualities of a manager which helps to really overcome employees' disruption at a family level or at an organization level? For one example, I have seen listening skill. You have to listen. Sometimes the disruption people can overcome only listening to them. So like that, what are the competencies a good manager should have to help people to overcome disruptions?
That's a good question, because, you know, people come with problems. You know, the person who's coming with problems will be very attached and emotional in that. But, you know, the listener is really impacted with the problem. So I would think, you know, the person who is listening is more capable of thinking, and the manager should be able to understand the situation and what's the best option that person should be doing. People who are in the problem will never think on those lines. Rather, you know, if somebody gives those, you know, kind of pointers, and you know, see, this is what is the best option. If I were in your place, maybe, you know, I would do this. So a manager should listen and understand and give, because the person who's already in the situation where he cannot think, he's already like, he or she will be thinking like, you know, I'm gone, I'm down and all. So maybe that is the best coaching a manager or a people manager or a HR person would counsel and coach.
Okay, good. So Shamila, back to you. How do this different culture manage disruptions?
Let me put it like this. You know, when I was in my earlier company, which is Panalpina, it's one of the world's third largest company. So they have every year a batch of 13 managing directors that they take from all over the world. They lock up us in a little small village in Switzerland, in a place called Liestal, which you may probably don't even know how to reach there except changing 3 trains from Zurich. And we are there every 3 weeks in for one whole year. And they ask you to be in that place and to train you so that anywhere in the world, any managing director, we have 650 over the world, anyone does not work, you're lifted and you're put into that situation. So suddenly, out of the blue, they say, you know, you're supposed to be going to this little village. Please carry your own little vices of biscuits and chocolates and whatever you want. So I said, these are crazy guys, you know. I'm going to Switzerland. Why would I carry my chocolates and sweets and biscuits and whatever other vices you have? And first of all, I said, but I'm already a managing director in my own country. So why should I go for this course? Then I said, no, no, please, you have to go for it and all that. So I landed up going to Zurich Airport. And it took me 3 trains. It was January, really freezing cold. 7:30 in the morning when, you know, all our flights land. The only person on the train. So even if I got lost, I didn't know whom to ask how to reach that village. Finally, I reached the village, which was a small station, which had this lovely, if you know Switzerland, has these little shops right next to the station. And I was wondering why the shop had everything possible. You know, from the juices to the chocolates to the biscuit, I looked at it and I said, I'm not carrying more luggage. I'm still in Switzerland, you know. And I didn't take anything. So the taxi came to take me, and after a 45 minutes drive, I reached this little hotel, which had only 15 rooms, exactly for us. And in the morning, if you woke up at 6 o'clock, it was like a scene out of that Kuch Kuch Hota Hai, only the cow with the bell. And I said, I must be joking. They really locked me up here. And I kept quiet, and then I asked next day, you were asked to ask questions how you managed to be chosen out of 15,000 employees, come down to 650 managing directors, come down to 13 people. So I, of course, said, you know, I'm already a managing director in my own country. Why am I here? You know, it's too degrading to be with these other junior people. And they said, you know what, we have Panalpina for 17 years in India. And we haven't had a single person that we took from India to understand how we could have an Indian as a managing director. So for me, it became a challenge that I was representing not just my country, but even my gender, because they never had a managing director lady anywhere in so many years in a Swiss company, which is an absolutely neutral country. And I did that for 1 year in the winters, in the colds, in whatever it was. And believe me, after I left, every year, they have not one, but they have at least 3 people from India now going to that batch. So for me, at a personal level, it became a huge challenge in terms of disruption, and they never expected that an Indian could be that. After my 6 months or 3 months, I would say, every time we had a group, this thing, they say, please, Sharmila, sit on the side, because every prize that would be there would go away to the Indians. You know how we are and how our brains work all the time. So after 3 months, I was not even asked to take part in anything, because every possible gift was with me. So it basically boils down to what you want. You need to ask for it. You need to go for it. And that's the only way you can become a really disruptive leader.
Hey, thank you very much. So before I open up for your questions to any one of us, I want to just substantiate what Shamila mentioned. I have seen from my experience, there are a lot of cultural differences working in different countries, and their appetite for disruption is different. You agree with that? For certain countries, they have, I'll share some of the, there is a lot of studies done on cultural differences and dimensions of culture. For example, is Western culture have a lot of appetite for risk, or Asian countries have a lot of appetite for risk? Which culture have appetite for risk? Western. So one of the very important diamonds for disruption is appetite to take risk. You agree? It's very, very important. That's the reason when you work with certain leaders in Western culture, they have very high appetite for risk. But we find as leaders sitting in here, we are very conservative. We don't take any risk. That's the one friction I find it. Second one, which culture, Western or Asian or Indian, want more information to take decision? We want more information. We love data. Isn't it? We keep on dating data, data, data. And we keep on digging bore well. Even after water comes, still we want to dig for more water. But Western culture require few data points to take decision. They move very fast. In disruption, you have to take decision and move. You cannot keep on debating on the data. I have seen that when I work with a global team, Indian managers and leaders want data, data, data for taking decision. By the time competition would have taken a decision and disrupted the business model. But Western leaders, they take decision very fast. Things are changing, don't take me wrong. So always I tell my leaders, information to interaction to action. Not data slicing and dicing and no action. You agree? So I was reading a lot of article on eagle. You know eagle, American? The national bird is eagle, isn't it? You have read about many articles on eagle. Eagle can live 60 to 70 years. You have read that story. I don't repeat it. You heard that story? Okay. Then another thing with eagle is, eagle after laying egg, once the egg hatches, eagle remove all the soft things what they kept it inside the nest. Why they do it? They want the young eagles to feel uncomfortable so that they can fly out of the nest and they can be independent. Isn't it? That's the culture in Western. After graduation and everything, they expect youngsters to go out of the home and take risk. But in Asian culture, we want our kids to be around us. But that's the reason we are emotionally want us to be that. There are differences. So I have seen a lot of cultural impact on disruption, which really changing the company or preventing the company. So I thought I'd just make that comment. With that, let us open up any questions for any one of us. Or thoughts or any comments or your own change story or disruption stories. I know it's the end of the day. All of you are tired. I could see this body language. Sir, again, we are going. Yeah.
So were you.
Yeah.
Sir Chandan sir mentioned a story about Xerox and it got me thinking of how Xerox for decades had been a main disruptor in information and technology and technology like the first computer mouse and all. And similarly Bell Labs, HP, other companies. And many of these companies share their many of these companies give their credit give the credit of their growth to Stanford University, because Stanford, as we all know, has been the birthplace of Silicon Valley basically. So my question to you is, what is the role of academic institutions do you think that they can play in market disruptions?
Yeah, that's a good question. So my point of view is, the basic premise of disruption is learning. Then Chandan also mentioned another premise of disruption is inquisitiveness. Isn't it? I want to learn more and more things about a phenomena or an opportunity. So academia can play a very important role of creating that learning platform for leaders. Academia can create a lot of platform for creating curiosity on a topic. For example, academia has created a lot of curiosity for me as a leader. The articles they publish, the research they publish, triggers thought or ideas as a leader to me, and I'll go behind that idea. They may not give the solution, academia may not give a solution, but they give a thought. They publish an article which I read, it may be Harvard or can be any of the, or IIM or XLRI, they publish an article that triggers a curiosity for a topic or an idea, and people go behind that idea. Today, a lot of Indian academy, I don't know how many of you know, Spare is a company which formed in IIM Bangalore. Spare, I know, when Spare started 10 years back, there is a student who did management studies, and the group students come up with an idea of that product, and it matured, and it become a $1 million product, and it's taking. So a lot of ideas coming today in academia which spark curiosity and changing the business models. So that is one. Second one is, I was talking to one of your professor that, you know, academia now creating lot of confidence in youngsters to become entrepreneurs. To lot of students coming out of today's good academia, they don't want to join any corporates. The teaching they do it on entrepreneurship, and the network they create in the school, the network they create in the school, create confidence in the students become entrepreneurs. Today, I was told in one of the best schools, 20 to 30% of the students does not want to join any companies. They want to be an entrepreneur because the confidence and the network they build in academia. So academia plays a very important role in terms of building learning, curiosity, confidence in corporate leaders as well as students to disrupt the environment. I don't know, any thoughts you want, any one of you have to add on this? Yeah.
You know, we had your colonel here with us. Your own, look at your own institute. It's given you a colonel, it's given you so many different types of professors who are all from different lines of business. And a very interesting thing also they told me is that most of the students are not from this area. You're from all over India. You yourself are a disruption. Because imagine somebody coming in from Gujarat or coming in from Maharashtra. You're all disrupting each other. And the success of Stanford and places like these are that you are not just alone. The academia has created the ground for you. And then you had colleagues like that. So exchanging and increasing your bank of influence of these kinds of people intellectually is what will lead you to the university giving you the backup for that. But it has to be your own effort at the end of the day.
But it's a very good question. I think they play Absolutely. A wonderful role. And I have seen, especially nowadays, academia have even like ISB. You can go after 10 years of your work experience and go there. And after that, you come up with a business model. We can disrupt the economy. Or in a positively, I'm telling. Not negatively. Positively, hopefully. Yep. Wonderful question. Yeah. Any other one or two questions? Yes. I know. Yep.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Neil Kanmur from IB Finance. Sir, in the later discussions, like when you discussed over here, you said that Indian culture and the Western culture which we are having, we can see is that the Western culture is more of destructive in nature, and they have a disruptive nature in themselves, and we Indians have a conservative nature. So my question after the discussions over here is that do the young managers feel that the Indian culture that has been embedded in us becomes an hindrance for the development, and how do the managers like us overcome that type of situation, like regarding to our cultures?
Yeah, it's a wonderful question. Let's give him a good clap. You know, I think real is very important. I've done a lot of work on culture. That was one of the topic I got excited very early part of my career. So the culture is changing a lot. For example, we as Indians, let me be very open with you. 10 years back, our consciousness on time was very different. Sharmila, you'll agree with me. Now we are very, very conscious on time, isn't it? 10 years back, we are not like that. We believe time is infinite. If I can't do anything in this birth, I will rebirth and finish that job. That was our religious belief, and that reflected in our timeliness. We come late and everything. Today we feel ashamed if you go late on meetings. If you slip schedule, we feel very guilty on that. Things are changing. But predominantly we believe time is infinite in our religious belief, and we can have rebirth and finish things. That is deep rooted in our beliefs. So things are changing, don't take me wrong. We are very conservative, we don't take risk. We want too many data, we debate our own data, we doubt our own data, so we don't take any decision. Things are changing. Especially millennium workers like you, who believes different things than my generation people. So things are changing. But what I will recommend to you, three things. Understand, what are the cultural differences? We call it as what? What are the differences which can stop you and put you in competency compared to other cultures? So what? How is it impacting my performance? Now what? What will I do differently? I come from a background where I don't take risk. If I want to be competing in the marketplace, I have to take risk. I come from a place where I want more and more data to take decision. But in this today's world, information, interaction, action should be very fast. So I need to change myself. So that, know your DNA, what we discuss, and conscious about yourself is what I am talking. Things are changing very fast, don't take me wrong. Especially youngsters like you are much different than 10 years back when I was a student 20 years back, we are different. But understand the differences and how it's impacting your performance and bridge the gap. That's the only thing I want to share. But yes, it can come on our way of performance. Our behavior and culture can come on our way of performance and efficient, but things are changing. Please acknowledge that.
So,
yeah.
So my question is, nowadays we see that there is high attrition rate in IT sector going on. So that is one disruption. So how this disruption will impact our Indian economy in coming 1 or 2 years or very, 5 years?
Very good question. So good questions deserve clap. You're okay, I'll take that question. I've done a lot of research on that. I will give an equation. We have done a lot of analytics on that. I'll tell you what is really happening in CSE. 3 years back, my labor cost was $16,000 per employee per annum. Today, it is $14,000 employee per annum. My target is to make $11,000 employee per annum per employee. 16 to 11,000. But my labor inflation is 9%, 8 to 9%. That means every year I give employees 8 to 9% average increase. It was 12%, now came down to 8-9%. That is industry trend. So when labor inflation happened 8 to 9%, how can I reduce from 16,000 to 11,000? Maths doesn't work. So that is reason sometimes use disruption to your competitive advantage. There's a case study. Use attrition to your competitive advantage. That means what we started looking at attrition in two dimensions, good attrition and bad attrition. When people leave, sometimes it's good. Say, thank you very much. I wish you could left me yesterday. You delayed it. Who are such people? Who are the people who do not learn? Who only believe in entitlement? Whose comp ratio keep on increasing and their comp ratio is more than one? They are in the middle of the pyramid. They keep on getting promoted every year without learning and without, but they keep on doing the same job year after year. And their performance rating is 3 and 4, that is bottom of the performance rating. If such people leave, I call it as, thank you very much, then I'll go back and hire people like you at the entry level and correct my compensation structure. That person was getting 35,000, I hire person with 5,000 at the bottom of the pyramid with a lot of energy, with a newer skill set and lot of learning agility. So we correct good attrition with a younger workforce at the bottom of the pyramid. When good attrition doesn't happen enough, what will you do? But good people, bad people doesn't leave, isn't it? They are very comfortable, they stay. We call sedimentation in the pyramid. We'll go and identify such people and what will you do? We let them go. So sometime attrition is good. But the way you look at disruption. So today, a lot of companies like us understood the game very well. Manage attrition or manage churn for your competitive advantage by correcting cost structure and make it part of your business model, then prevent delivery leakage, knowledge leakage, and make knowledge management and delivery management built around this model. That's what Indian companies are doing. As a result, our cost structure become competitive year after year. Nobody can beat us on cost structure on that. So that is disruption. Make a business model around that disruption. Make sense? That's what we are learning to do that better, better. Make sense? Yeah.
Sir?
Last question. In the, I know. Yeah.
Sir?
Who are having the mic, get the advantage. Yeah.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, sir. My name is Reva, specializing in finance. So you mentioned that the So you mentioned that the Indian managers, before taking a decision, they require a lot of data as compared to those of the Western managers. Do you not think or do you not believe that for taking any decision, data is important to analyze both the pros and cons of the decision instead of just looking at the pros and ignoring the cons and realizing that the decision taken was wrong later? Thank you.
Okay. Maybe you want to take one of you, then I'll add my perspective. From your experience, you want to comment on that, one of you, then I'll add.
Now, from a finance perspective, if you ask about data, we don't need it. Because what you're going to take a decision on is based on your finance. Shall I or shall I not do it? So you don't need any back for it. You're going to look forward exactly as he said. Is that so-called data that you're working on, are we looking at converting that back to a profit, or are you going to go back into a loss? So as he rightly said, we take a decision on, if I do this, will I make the money quicker? So why should I look behind? I don't have to. I'm looking in the front, and to look in the front, we don't wait for data. In the multinationals, we don't do it. But as you rightly said, yes, in a lot of Indian companies, we still say that the trend went for 5 years like this. Next 2 years, it went like this. Next 2 years, it might become like this. We don't do that. We don't do that. We don't have the time to do that because we just look forward. We don't look backward. And that is why we don't look at data for backward. When you don't look at backwards, you look forward, you don't keep data. That's good. Our perspective.
Yeah, go ahead.
Data is required, but you know to what extent the data is required. You know, if you spend just collecting the data, when are you taking a decision? So we need to know where to draw a line, and you know, you should look at the cycle time and how it is impacting. Like, you know, while we hire and, you know, rehire and all these kind of life cycles, we calculate the number of days and, you know, we'll take an appropriate decision, you know, how business is impacting. So I think data is required, but it is not the only thing that we are looking at.
I think that's a good point both Shamila and Sapna mentioned. I'll make one statement. That's the essence of everything. A moving object always can change direction. A static object cannot change direction. So what we tell managers, move. If you waiting for a perfect solution to make a decision, that solution never come. But problem with a lot of managers, they want a perfect solution through a simulation of data. As a result, they take weeks and months together, and you become incompetent in the marketplace because you don't take decision. What we are telling, go with the very minimum data points, interact with the different stakeholders, and take a decision and move, and you may make mistakes, but you can correct it later. If you don't move, how can you change direction? So move. I always tell, move. Don't wait for a perfect solution, move. That process in agile methodology is called rapid prototyping. And come up with a workable solution may not be the perfect solution in the world. If you work for a perfect solution, you never build perfect solution, or you may build it may be too late. So data, interaction and action, that cycle time has to be significantly reduced. I'm not telling data is not important. Go with the fewer data points. Interact fast. Take a decision and move. May not be the right decision, but we'll correct it. That dynamism in management is more important rather than beaten by data and never able to come out of it. That's a very bad behavior. Make
Thank
sense?
You, panel members. Thank yeah. you, sir.
Okay, Suresh, we are getting closer, isn't it? Okay, as a closing remark. Yeah, one more. Okay, he has been raising his hand. We'll give him. Poor guy did not get the mic. Last question. Okay, two questions. Yeah. You're okay, Shamila? Okay. I'm only going tomorrow, so I can stay back. Only worried about Sharmila and yeah. Because Suresh has taken my entire day.
Good evening, sir.
Yeah.
So I wanted to ask you one thing. Like, I've seen how CIA was formed. I've seen the video. They've taken people from all over the country. The top, like the cobbler, the top renowned cobbler, the cook, top cook. Like those, they took people top on their activities. And now what I see here, and how that's how they formed the CIA. And they came out with disruptive technologies like we see the drones and all. They have tried all things. After doing a lot of study, from that came the disruptive technology. now what I've seen is that I got a mail from mygovernment.in, mygov.in. There I've seen a, means, now what they're doing, they're calling people, means all the experienced people, or like retired, of irrespective of their field, for various data processing activities. So do you think, is it the, means the government is taking steps to create disruptive technology or disruptive things to come out, or they are motivating the old age people, like old people or retired professionals?
You know, I'm not expert on that. I don't have a view. I don't want to try it, what government is trying to do. But one thing, what we are doing it in business is also when it comes to mainframe technology and some of the legacy technology, we want people who are deeper in domain. We are not worried about age, retired or as long as people can work. In corporate worlds also, we are calling back people who have deeper domain knowledge, which is missing in corporate world today, to come back and work. So we have done it in many areas in corporate, where we are getting retired people on a part-time basis or a full-time basis, especially mainframe technology, certain domain like healthcare, insurance and everything, we find that is dying very fast. So we want to extend and call him. Maybe government also trying to do that, certain domain, they find it, they want deeper domain knowledge and expertise, and they find it, maybe retired people may have it, so they're calling back to build that domain knowledge in terms of systems, process and products. That's what they're trying to do. That's my guess, but I'm not an expert on that. Yeah. Okay, last question.
Sir, your company, the merger with HP.
My God.
Is it a move to tackle the future disruption? Because work of a manager is just not to tackle disruption, but to predict the future disruption. So was that a move for that? Because Chandan sir mentioned that disruption is a part of life and it is not
disruption. Yeah, exactly. So we clearly see a lot of things going to happen. In future, if you really look at HP and CSC in terms of technology, like... Yeah, exactly. So two, three reasons why it is done. One is we know that in future to create disruption, we want scale. So with this two companies coming together, we get scale to create disruption. If you are small, you cannot create disruption. That's one reason. Two companies together with 2 lakhs employees, with 73 countries, with 5,000 customers, we get the scale to create disruption. Second one is both companies have certain verticals which is specialized. We are very good in insurance, banking and healthcare. HP Services is very good in healthcare, transportation, banking and financial market, and life sciences. So we have certain verticals which is missing, which HP is going to bring it, which is very important to create disruption in the marketplace. Third one, certain technology like cyber, big data, we call it as MAC, emerging technology, social, mobile, analytics, cyber, which is going to be the future of the company, and we call it as digital enterprise or digitalization. We organically creating that will be very slow. But both companies coming together, the next generation technology can be built very faster, which is what the world is looking at. And we can create that disruption coming together. These are the three reasons. Then fourth reason is certain geography, HP is very strong. Including India, they are very strong. We are not that strong. And Asian countries, they are very strong, like Singapore, Japan. Japan, they are very strong. So certain market, if you want to create disruption, we want scale and partners to create that disruption. That is the reason they bring it to the table. Make sense? Okay. So in I don't want to make a closing remark. Thank you very much. Sharmila, appreciate your thoughts. Sapna, appreciate your thoughts. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you all the panel members for such a wonderful session. Lot of information and ideas were discussed. Lot of information and ideas were discussed on the topic disruptive leadership. We look forward to have more sessions like this. We are grateful to have you all. May I now request Dr. K.K. Valuri, Director BITM, to present memento to Ms. Sharmila Amin as a token of her love and appreciation.
Now request Professor D.S. Kadam, Director Projects and Alumni Affairs, to present a memento to Ms. Swapna Jaladi as a token of love and appreciation. Thank you all.